लोकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः. टुडे इज द होली डे ऑफ स्वामी अखंडानंदजी'स बर्थ. दिस इज द 147th बर्थडे ऑफ स्वामी अखंडानंदजी. He was born on a Friday. It was a Mahalaya day on 30th September 1864. His father was Srimanta Bandopadhyaya and mother was Vama Sundari Devi. It is said that his mother did not experience any labor pain at all. She was just sitting on a mat and talking. And she gave birth to this child without any labor pain. As a child, Gangadhar, he was named as Gangadhar Vandopadhyaya. So this Gangadhar, from his childhood, he was averse to any type of wealth or riches. It is said that when he was a small baby, some relative gave a present of a gold chain, a thin gold chain, and they wanted the mother to put it around the neck of this child. So this child, one and a half year old, the chain was put around his neck. As soon as it was put, the child did not like that necklace at all, or that neck chain at all. He went on pulling at it, and he would not keep quiet until he tore it and threw it away. So he tore away that piece of gold that was put around his neck. That shows his future life, how he remained as an unattached sadhu, a great sannyasi. And as the boy grew up, people noticed he had a tremendous concentration. So he would go along with his friends, and when he would find a mango tree, naturally the small children, they all want to make the mango fall down. So the only instrument they have is the stones. They picked up the stones and they start hitting at the mangoes, and mangoes would fall. When the other children would be hitting recklessly here and there, Gangadhar would not, he would just aim at one mango only. I must get that particular mango. He would just aim at it and would make that one mango fall. Just like an Arjuna, just hitting at the eye of the bird. So even from the childhood, he had developed this power of concentration, which was one of the characteristics of Swami Vivekananda also. Sri Ramakrishna told that Swami Vivekananda is a past master of meditation. So right from his young childhood, he had this tremendous power of concentration. Here we have the Gangadhar also manifesting this power of concentration right from his childhood. And also he had a tremendous power of forbearance, what we call as a purume, titiksha in Sanskrit. Titiksha is to forbear, to bear with all the difficulties without complaining against anybody or anything. So once he developed a wound between his eyebrows, he was a boy of 8 years only. Then in those times, there was no other local anesthesia. For everything, they had to give a general anesthesia. So the doctor said, yes, we have put him under general anesthesia and then we will operate. Then this child said, no, I don't want general anesthesia. You can operate, I will keep quiet. First, they were all wonderstruck. How this boy can keep quiet when incision is made between his eyebrows? But actually he sat very, very quiet when the incision was made between his eyebrows and the wound was set right. So that was the tremendous forbearance this boy had even at 8 years. When he was hardly 12 years, he heard that a Paramahamsa had come to his neighborhood, to one gentleman, Kalinath Basu, to his house. When he heard that some Paramahamsa has come, at 12th year, he got very much interested. I must go and see the Paramahamsa. So he went all the way and entered into the house. There he saw Sri Ramakrishna completely absorbed in samadhi. And then afterwards he started singing. After singing this, he was singing when he went, he found Sri Ramakrishna singing a song. And the song was, he was singing to Kali. He was praying to Kali, "You please give up your sword and then you take flute like Krishna and then you dance." So Sri Ramakrishna was praying to Kali, "You give up this sword, take up a flute like Krishna and dance." Krishna also danced. Kali also dances. So Sri Ramakrishna wants to see Krishna in Kali. Asityaje bunsi loye akbar nacho go shyama. He was singing in Bengali. And his voice was so sweet. He was full of devotion, shedding tears of joy. And then Sri Ramakrishna merged into samadhi. He went into deep ecstasy. So all this impressed Gangadhar very much. He was only just 12 years at that time. Then after some time, he was very much devoted to the sadhus and sannyasis. One sannyasi from the north, Udasi sannyasi, the sannyasi of the Nanak Panth. The Sikhs have a sannyasi parampara, sannyasi lineage. So this sannyasi, Udasi sannyasi, so he came to their house just for begging. So Gangadhar was very much impressed by this sadhu. And then he offered that, "I will also follow you." Perhaps mother was somewhere away, and so he just walked away with the sannyasi. So mother came and then finds that this 12-year-old boy is not at home. Where has he gone? She inquired here and there, and people said that sannyasi had come to your house and your son was talking to him. Then she thought, "Oh, this sannyasi has taken away my son." She went on visiting all the pilgrimages where sannyasis are there so that she can find her son. So she went to Allahabad, she went to Banaras, she went to Vrindavan, she went to Kankhal, Haridwar, Rishikesh, all these places she visited, but she could not find her son. She came back to Varanasi, where she met Trailinga Swami. Trailinga Swami was a Siddha Purusha. He was a God-realized soul. As when she inquired him whether she would get her son, he said, "Yes, you will get your son, go back." And when she came back to Calcutta, in the meanwhile, Gangadhar had returned home. So she found him at home. She became very furious. She said, "Why were you born in my house? If you want to make me weep like this," then Gangadhar replied, "You see, if I had not taken birth in your house and had not been lost like this, would you have visited all the pilgrimages? So you would have had all your pilgrimages because of me only." As if you know, he has taken his birth to help his mother do pilgrimages. See, that age itself, he understands that he has to help the world. For the sake of the world, he has to do things. That awakening has come inside him. So, first time, when he was at this age of 12, he met Sri Ramakrishna also, as I said, in Kalinath Basu's house. Then second time when he met Sri Ramakrishna, it was already another 7-8 years past. Second meeting, he met him at Dakshineshwar. "Have you seen me earlier?" Sri Ramakrishna asked him. "Yes, as a boy." Naturally, he had met him when he was 12 years old. Sri Ramakrishna was amused. Even 19-year-old is also a young boy only. So, as a boy, he says, as if there was another boyhood for this fellow. Sri Ramakrishna was amused hearing that reply. And then he told Gangadhar, "You come on a Saturday. Saturday is a very sweet day. Madhuvar. Madhuvar is a sacred day, sweet day." Sri Ramakrishna liked young people who wanted to discuss with him or learn from him the spiritual life. They should come on Tuesdays or Saturdays. Mangalwar or Shanivar. He used to call both days as Madhuvar. So another day, after some time, the next meeting, Gangadhar went to Sri Ramakrishna, and then Sri Ramakrishna asked him to sit on a mat on the ground, then taught him how to sit for meditation, neither very stiff straight nor bent very much, in a loose position, in a straight position you must sit. He taught him how to sit and then wrote on his tongue some mantra, and then he went into deep meditation. So afterwards he was asked to massage the legs of Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna was lying down. So this young man, he was 19, 20 years old, very strong. He used to go to gymnasium also. So with his strong muscles, he pressed Sri Ramakrishna's legs so hard. Sri Ramakrishna shouted, "No, no, no, not that hard. So you do it very mildly." Then Swami Gangadhar found that Sri Ramakrishna was not like any other ordinary man. His bones were also soft, he says. Our muscles are soft, but his bones were also soft like butter. So I was using unnecessarily too much of my energy, so it was not very comfortable for him. So he said, "No, no, no, massage me very mildly." So that another day he went, another day when he met Sri Ramakrishna. Then Sri Ramakrishna asked about him, "What do you eat? What do you take after meals? Do you take pan? How many times do you eat?" So he replied. Then Sri Ramakrishna, after hearing that he takes only two times food, and that food also he cooks for himself, and that food also there is no vegetable or no spices, nothing, only rice and salt and ghee with it, what you call Havishyanna, ghee bath. So every day he only cooks for himself and eats two times in a day and take Ganga bath three times in a day, just like old people. So Sri Ramakrishna was astonished at this old habit of this young boy. "Why do you observe this oldish rules of food?" Sri Ramakrishna asked him. And then he advised him, "See Narendra, the future Swami Vivekananda. Go and meet Narendra and see Narendra. He eats anything that comes his way, but then he sees Narayana in everyone, even in the streets of Calcutta." That is what is important in spiritual life. Not what you eat, how many times you eat, how many times you take bath, but what is your inner purity. If inner purity is there, we see God everywhere. So he tells, "You see Narendra, he eats everything. He eats several times pan, but he sees Narayana in everyone in Calcutta." So Gangadhar was very much impressed. Later on he went and saw Swami Vivekananda, and he was completely fascinated by him. Later on we see in his life all the ideals of Swami Vivekananda being practiced by Gangadhar with a very, very great earnestness. And in fact, we see in his life a wonderful combination of all the teachings of Swamiji. Swamiji wanted everybody to shape one's personality on all the four yogas: Bhakti Yoga, Jnana Yoga, Karma Yoga, Raja Yoga. Gangadhar was an ideal like that. So Swamiji impressed him very much. Then after one day he went to Sri Ramakrishna again. Then Sri Ramakrishna sent him for meditation. He went and meditated. After he returned from meditation, Sri Ramakrishna asked him, "Did you shed tears while you were meditating?" Then Gangadhar said, "Yes, I did. You see, you should pray to Mother like this, shedding tears of love." And Sri Ramakrishna sat like a child. He throwing both the legs and hands like this, like in the doll, we find the children's doll, like that, both the legs and hands. So Sri Ramakrishna threw his both legs and hands like that, started crying to Mother, "Oh Mother, please give me bhakti, please give me jnana, please give me yourself. So I want you alone. I don't want anybody else. He started weeping like a child for minutes together. Gangadhar learned what tremendous love he had for mother, that he could just by within a minute, he could develop so much of love for mother. He started weeping like that. So that impressed him very deeply. One another day, Gangadhar was with Sri Ramakrishna. They were talking about Brahma Samaj and other religious organizations perhaps. And then the topic of theosophy came. Theosophy was also there at that time of Sri Ramakrishna. So Colonel Wolcott was the world president of the World Theosophy Movement. So this Colonel Wolcott had given up his Christian religion and had become a Ceylonese Buddhist. So he was in Ceylon for some time. He was for quite some time in Madras also. Swamiji met him in Madras when in 1892-93. So Colonel, the Gangadhar told Sri Ramakrishna, Colonel Wolcott, the head of the Theosophy, World Theosophy Movement, he has given up his Christian religion and has become a Hindu. At that time, Buddhism, Hinduism were considered as one only. Even now they are one. Now there is a political difference now. Whereas at that time there was not so much politics. They consider Buddhism and Hinduism as one only. So he says he has become a Hindu. Immediately Sri Ramakrishna's reaction was, why should he become a Hindu? He should have remained as a Christian. If he wants to do sadhana, why should he give up his religion? Each one will hold on to his own religion. That was the greatness of Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna, when he said all religions are true and each has to follow his own religion, he didn't mean that only the Hindus should follow their religion, they should not give up. He did not want the Christians also to give up their religion or Buddhists to give up their religion. So Sri Ramakrishna is recorded in gospel that Sri Ram, as soon as Gangadhar said, Colonel Wolcott has given up his Christian religion, he has become a Hindu. Why should he become a Hindu? He expressed his astonishment at it. Then Gangadhar one day was in the Kali temple. Sri Ramakrishna was also in the Kali temple. And Gangadhar was standing near Kali. And we all know Kali's statue is there. She is standing on the chest of Shiva. And Shiva is lying down as if, you know, he is in Samadhi. Then suddenly Sri Ramakrishna told Gangadhar, see Gangadhar, Shiva is there. See Shiva there. Then Shiva, he thought it's the statue of Shiva or the image of Shiva. When he looked at Shiva, there was a living Shiva. Shiva was breathing. She was looking at Kali. And then breathing Shiva, Gangadhar sees. That was the power of Sri Ramakrishna. He could show God to anyone by a mere will. That day he had the glorious darshan of living Shiva. Then we all know that August 16th, 1886, Sri Ramakrishna gives up his body in Mahasamadhi. Then after Sri Ramakrishna leaves this world, then all the other direct disciples, they all form the Baranagar Mutt. Varaha Nagara is called Baranagar. So in that Baranagar they hired a haunted house, and that was the first monastery of the Ramakrishna Mutt. So there all the young people who had come to see Ramakrishna, like Narendra, Rakhal, all these youngsters, they all formed into a group, and the Ramakrishna Mutt was started there. So just after 1 year, in 1887, Gangadhar wanted to go on a long pilgrimage to Himalayas. So he was just in 1886, he was just around 22-year-old young man. So when he started for pilgrimage, he went first. He wanted to go to Kedar, Badri, Amarnath and all other Tirthas in the Himalayas. So when he went to Rishikesh is the point from there you enter Himalayas. and Ganga enters the plains at Rishikesh. So when he went to Rishikesh, he found a great sadhu there called Mayaram Avadhut. He had gone several times to Himalayan Yatra, Kedar, Badri, Gangotri, Yamunotri, Gomukh, and beyond that to Tibet also. So he had visited several times. He had a great name. And he is a great sadhu also. He was doing satsang. Then Gangadhar straight entered into the satsang, went to Mayaram Avadhut and asked him, "Sir, can you show me the path which leads me to Kedar? I want to go to Kedar." This young man, as soon as he asked this question, then Mayaram Avadhut showed the path, which was a straight road leading towards the Kedar. So then Gangadhar looked at that road. "But it is an ordinary road. I thought the path to Kedarnath is from one hillock to another hillock. You must jump from one hillock to another. And thus you have to go and reach Kedar," I thought. Not only he thought, he has come ready to do that, from jumping from one hillock to another like Hanuman and reaching Kedar. So he was ready to do that. Then Mayaram Avadhut was taken aback by the reply of Gangadhar. He told his disciples that were there around, "See the grace of his guru. If the guru is great, the shishya, the disciple, will get this tremendous spirit. Guru meharban to chela pahalwan." If the guru is gracious, the disciple becomes very strong. That is how his guru must have been very strong. Perhaps he did not know about Sri Ramakrishna. That is why this young man had the spirit from jumping from hillock to hillock and reaching Kedar and the other tirthas. Then Gangadhar, he started his journey towards Himalayas. He got luckily a group of traders who were going to Tibet. So he said, "All right, I will go with these people to Tibet." He followed them. They also took him. So they went all into the Tibet, and there was a particular point. It was almost evening. Those traders, they were not interested in making this young man reach a nearby monastery. They just showed him the path to a monastery at a place called Kuling. Kuling was the crossing point, something like a crossroads. So they had to go by another road. They said, "We don't have time to come to your monastery. There you walk this road and then you will get there, Kuling, the Tibetan monastery. You will go and reach there. It's a little distance from here." They showed him and they went away. And then Gangadhar could not find the monastery. Just he walked a little distance. Perhaps it was quite long distance. In the meanwhile, the whole thing became dark. It is all Himalayas. Darkness means pitch dark. You cannot even see anything just a few inches away. We have lived in the northeast region. When the night comes, there is no light. Even the stars are all dead. They cannot shed in light there because of this so much of mist and snow. Even starry light does not reach you. Darkness means darkness. Terrific. So he could not proceed. And it was freezing winter. So what could he do? He just sat there, started thinking about Sri Ramakrishna and lay himself down. So when he opened his eyes, he found the monks from the nearest monastery, the Tibetan monks. They had come, they were nursing him. He was almost dead. So they were trying to bring him back to life. He was not completely dead. Therefore, they could bring him back to life. As soon as he started opening his eyes and started recognizing people, those monks started shouting, "Oh, here is a very, very sacred person. That is why almost from the jaws of death he has come back. Otherwise, anybody who lies down amidst that ice, in 3-4 minutes all his nerves get benumbed and he passes away. That is why when you go to Himalaya Yatra, whenever there is such dangerous places are there where it is very cold or very height is very much, 10,000 feet, 11,000 feet, boards are put. Don't sit here. Don't go for rest here. walk, walk, walk. You should never sit at that place. If you sit, then you will sleep. If you sleep, you are benumbed and dead. That's all, finished. So this Swami, this Gangadhar has slept the whole night and then he is alive. So he must have been a very sacred person. So they started telling, Gelam, Gelam. Lam means Lama, the sacredest person, most sacred person, Lama. So Gelam, here is a very sacred person. That is why he has been alive amidst this cold. Then Sri Ram, he stayed there for quite, I think, a year or two. And then he tried to help the poor people also. But the people there, the monastery heads, they were all quite well-to-do in a way. In Buddhism, when you see, the monks live in very comfortably. All the householders take care of them. So there also it was there. The monks were all very comfortable in their monasteries. Common people were suffering. Then Gangadhar started helping them. But the monastery's people did not like it. Afterwards he left the monastery, started his trek back. So when he is coming back to India, so the same hard path is there. One day he was going towards a jungle path to reach a village on the other side. It was already evening. But people said, no, no, don't go by this path. There is a longer path, you rather go by that one. This is a very terrific jungle. Lot of wild beasts are there. But he said, why? Sri Ramakrishna is there to protect me. Let me go by this. So he had so much of faith in Sri Ramakrishna. He started walking in the jungle path. And it was night. And then as he walks along, he finds so many animals have been preyed upon by the bigger animals. And fresh blood and fresh bones are lying there. So many animals have gone into the stomachs of these tigers and lions. So, but he got a little frightened. But then his faith in Sri Ramakrishna was there. He went on walking. Sri Ramakrishna somehow led him out safely. No wild beast, no tiger or lion came to molest him. So he reached the other side. Another time, he was again in a jungle. So it was not a jungle like this, where full of beasts, but it was a peaceful jungle. So he started meditating there. So when he started meditating, he went into deep trance. Suddenly Sri Ramakrishna appeared. And Sri Ramakrishna appears and tells him, hey Ganga, this whole Himalayas is Shiva. And all the greenery, the flowers, the fruits, all this beautiful thing, this is all Shakti. This is Shiva and Shakti. The greeneries and the beautiful nature and the white Himalayas. So these two represent Shakti and Shiva Leela, the sport of Shakti and Shiva. And saying this one, he came to Gangadhar. It is all he is meditating. So in his vision, his feeling, Sri Ramakrishna placed his hands on his shoulders and started singing. Bajbego Maheshir Buke Neme Dada Ar Nachishne Shama Kapa Magi. So he started telling, oh mad lady, addressing Kali. Sri Ramakrishna is singing this song. Oh mad lady, dance no more on Shiva's chest. Please come down. So these are all very wonderful songs about mother. So that song, a child, as it plays with the mother, so the bhakta sings and enjoys it. Sri Ramakrishna started singing this song, placing his hands on the shoulders of Gangadhar, and Gangadhar also got up. Both of them started singing the song and dancing the whole night. So they were dancing and singing, and they did not know how the time went away. When Gangadhar came to senses, then Sri Ramakrishna disappeared from his vision. He found it was the whole night, it was his vision, and he was dancing and singing with Sri Ramakrishna. Such was the tremendous experience of Swami Gangadhar, Swami Akhandananda ji, somewhere unsurpassed by many, many people, many great Mahatmas also, after spending like this, then he returned to Baranagar after 4 years. And he came to Baranagar and took sannyas. In the meanwhile, all other direct disciples had taken sannyas. Narendranath had taken sannyas. He did not assume any particular name. Brahmananji had assumed the name Brahmananda. Premanandaji, Baburam had become Premananda. Like that, he also came. And after doing the proper rituals, assumed the name Akhandananda. That was in 1890. In 1892, Swami Vivekananda also wanted to go to Himalayas. Swami Vivekananda did not go very far up to 1892 for about 6 years. He would go to Banaras, he would come back. But in 1892 he thought, let us go to Himalayas and from there, whole of Bharat I want to go around. So when he wanted to go, he wanted Akhandananda also to come with him. Because Akhandananda had the experience, so both of them started. So they went to several places. But Swamiji could not go very high. A few places only he could visit, Kedar and Badri, but he could not go beyond that. He also wanted to go to Tibet. All his life he had a desire to go to Tibet. He never went to Tibet. It was Akhandananji who went to Tibet, and later on Abhedananji went to Tibet. It was difficult in those days to go. Even today also it is difficult because of the conveyances and the plane, etc. People are able to go to Tibet. So Swamiji could not go much into the interior of Himalaya. Then they came back, and at Meerut, many other Swamis were also there, of the their brother disciples. They all met at Meerut. They stayed for some time. At Meerut, Swami Vivekananda told all the other brother disciples, you see, I have got an inner voice. So I am getting an inner inspiration that I should go alone. I must do my pilgrimage alone. Therefore, none of you will know about me. I will go ahead, and when God wishes, we shall come together. When he said like this, that none of you will know about me, immediately Akhandananji told, I shall know about you wherever you go. Even if you go to the underworld, Patala, I will find you out. So Gangadhar told like this. Anyway, Swamiji did not bother much. He started off. He went away towards Rajputana and Gujarat. After some days, spending some days in Delhi, Akhandananda thought, let me go and find out where this Naren has gone. So he started following the trek of Narendra. So he goes to a place, they say, oh, some 10 days back there was Swami Sachidananda was here. So he Vividishananda was here. Swamiji was changing his name every 6 months or every 7 months or every 2 months. So he was changing his name to Vividishananda, Sachidananda. Vivekananda's name became permanent only in 1893, in May, when he met Khetri Raja before sailing to America. He took the permanent name of Vivekananda. When he came to Madras also, he was known as Sachidananda only. The Madrasis, Alasinga, etc., they knew Swamiji as Sachidananda only. They did not know Vivekananda. Only when he went away to America, there the name was announced, Vivekananda became famous. People could not know. It is not Sachidananda, it is Vivekananda. How to connect Vivekananda and Sachidananda? So Swamiji, the people used to say to Gangadhar, oh, here he came 10 days back, there was one Swami who went by this way to Narayan Sarovar. Oh, he has gone to Narayan Sarovar. You all know Narayan Sarovar is Bhuj. Beyond Bhuj you have to go to the Arabian Sea. There you will get this Narayan Sarovar. It is a hard job to cover by foot. There are a lot of dacoits on the way. But Gangadhar said, I must find out Swamiji wherever he is. So he started going to Baroda, then Ahmedabad, Junagadh, Porbandar, Dwarka, Bhuj and Kach Mandvi. Then Ashapuri, then he goes to Narayan Sarovar. Covering hundreds of miles on foot,
There are lots of decoys are there. So he knew that decoys would come and they may even attack. People had told him, if the decoys catch you, even if you have got a foreigner coin with you, they will take the foreigner coin and then they will murder you and go. This is how the decoys of that Narayan Sarovar or Bhuj area are. So he did not want to die on the way. He wanted to meet Swamiji. Therefore he asked those people, can you teach me that please don't kill me, don't kill me. You take away whatever is with me. You tell me what is to be told to the dacoits. The dacoit language somebody taught him. So, medegano, medegano. That means don't kill me, don't kill. No, you take away whatever is with me. Muke mario mu, don't kill me. So take away whatever is there with me, but don't kill me. He learned this much. So actually when dacoits came and attacked, so he shouted these words at them. Medegano, medegano, muke mario mu. Please take away whatever I have. Don't kill me. They did exactly the same thing. They took away everything except his loin cloth and then they left him off. Then he went up to Narayan Sarovar. When he goes to Narayan Sarovar, he finds that Swamiji had left that place a few days earlier. Again he traces back by the same dangerous route and sees Swamiji in a place called Ashapuri. There Swamiji was sitting and then he was talking to all the devotees. Then Akhandananda says, at that time Gangadhar says, Swamiji is not a person I saw. He was like an idea. He was like a divine being like Shuka sitting in that room. Whole room was full of light emanating from his body. So he is giving his ideas. Everybody is drowned in the sweetness of his ideas. That is how Gangadhar saw Swami Vivekananda. Afterwards, like this, after seeing Swamiji, Swamiji begged him, Gangadhar, I know you will find me out wherever I go, but please don't pursue me. I want to go alone. Please leave me alone. He said, all right, I will leave you now. Then he returned to the monastery, which had been shifted from Baranagar to Alam Bazar. So after 5 years, he was back. Then he was there for some time. In the meanwhile, Swamiji has gone to West, and Western, all the work was finished. Swamiji returned to India, and in 1897, he came back to India. And then after going through Colombo to Almora, so he was at Darjeeling. At that time, Gangadhar was in Alam Bazar Mutt. He thought, let me go and see some historical places around Calcutta. So one of the historical places, most important historical place was Plassey. The War of Plassey was the last war that was fought by an Indian king. Afterwards, India surrendered and the British entered Calcutta through Plassey. So he wanted to see Plassey, where India had been subjugated. Again, the freedom of India must start from the very place where she was subjugated. That was his idea. So he went to Plassey in Murshidabad district. And then he went round and round, saw the old Plassey king's palaces and all that, how the British army entered. So all that history he learned. Then it was night. So he rested in a small temple in a place called Bapta. It's a small village. And he found there was famine all around. There was no drinking water, no food to eat. Everywhere there was famine and famine. Everybody was asking for something to eat, something to clothe. He was very much perturbed. So he took rest in the night. Next day morning he wanted to walk away and come back to Alam Bazar Mutt. But when the next morning he wanted to get up, then somebody pushed him down. And he had to sit. Again he wanted to get up. Again he felt that some hands are pushing him down. 3 times he wanted to get up. 3 times he was pushed down. And he heard a divine voice saying, where will you go now? You have to do a lot of work here for these people. he heard this voice. Then he thought it is Sri Ramakrishna's voice. So he started relief work there. And then he informed Alambadharmat, Swami Brahmananji was there, and he told him that I am doing relief work here, I am starting relief work. Then they advised him, what relief work will you do? You have no money. You have no money, you have no men. How will you do relief work? You come away. You are only a sadhu, you come away. Then he wrote to them saying, when people are suffering, I cannot run away like a coward. I would rather die along with them than running away from them. So I have started this work, I will continue to do. Swami Vivekananda in Darjeeling, he came to know about this relief work. Swamiji was very much pleased. That was the first relief work in 1897, started by the mission, the work at Mahula. So this Mahula village, relief work continued. Swamiji was very happy. He said, cheerio, you are a hero. I will send you money, don't worry. So you go on. So he used to go to Muslim mosques. After their prayer, he would address the Muslims of Murshidabad and collect money from them or rice from them, come and distribute to the famine-stricken people. And later on, government also gave help and people got some relief. This was how the first relief work was started. At the same time, he found during that famine, many parents had died. Some children were there, left orphans. So he collected all those orphans and started an orphanage at a place called Sargachi, which has now grown into a big center of the mission. And in the orphanage, he used to keep the children, and he would consider them as Narayana himself. Every day morning when he would bathe the children, he would utter the mantra from the Vedas, Sahasra Shirsha Purusha, Sahasra Aksha Sahasra Path. Telling this mantra, he would bathe the children, just as we do in the temples, bathing the Shivalinga or bathing Salagrama. You utter this mantra and pour water. So he used to treat the children as Narayana himself. That was Vivekananda's instruction. This is the way we have to worship the people. The people are not people, they are the temples of God. Narayana himself is there in everyone. So he must worship Narayana. So during this time he wanted sometimes to go to Varanasi. He had written to his friend, one great Pandit Pramadadas Mitra, I will come. But he could not leave this work of the orphanage. Every time he was postponing. Then Pramadadas Mitra wrote to him strongly once, you are caught in Maya of that orphanage. That's why you are not coming to Varanasi for the darshan of Vishwanatha. Then Akhandananda writes a reply to him saying, sir, I also at one time thought like that to live with people is Maya. So that's why I went away into far off Himalayas for years together. But now I see Narayana in everyone. God is there in every human being. God, as if he is telling in my ears, Krishna was man, Rama was man, Buddha was man, all rishis were men. It is through men you have to see the Lord. And serve Lord through men. So God is telling in my ears as it were. So that is how I am serving these boys. Then one Nepali boy dies in the hostel one day. So Sri Gangadhar used to love that boy much. So Gangadhar shed copious tears. Suddenly he got the idea, am I really caught by Maya just like other people in the world? When somebody dies, they also weep out of attachment. Have I also developed attachment to this boy? Suddenly he sees Sri Ramakrishna appears before him as an all-pervading light. And then Sri Ramakrishna tells him, no, you are untouched by Maya. You are free. It is your daya that makes you weep. There is a lot of difference between daya and Maya, Sri Ramakrishna used to say. Maya is only to one, a few people who are biologically attached to you, whereas daya is for the whole world. So you are weeping out of daya. You are untouched by Maya. So Sri Ramakrishna assures him. Then on July 4th, 1902, we know Sri Swami Vivekananda passes away in Mahasamadhi in Belurmat. And Akhandananda was very much grieved. He did not want to live at all after Swamiji passed away. Because I was working for Swamiji only. Swamiji was my ideal. Now Swamiji is no more. Why should I work? So he wanted to commit suicide, standing on the line of the tram. So tram was rushing down. He is standing on the tram line to be crushed by tram. Suddenly Swami Vivekananda, in the divine vision, appeared. He said, "Hey Ganga, what are you doing? Come, come." So he moved away from the tram line. Then Swamiji says, "Do you think I am dead? I am alive. I am going to live. I am going to help people till the end of time." So Swamiji spoke to him. Then he was very much assured that Swamiji is still there. And then he started his work again. In the meanwhile, he wanted to expand his work in Sargachi. A Muslim zamindar gave 16 acres in donation. "I'll give you, you do your work, work of the ashram." So to accept this donation, he wrote to headquarters in Belurmat. Belurmat Swami Brahmananji was there as the president. He said, "If you take 16 acres of land, land tax you have to pay every year. So how will you pay? Take only half of it. You leave another half." Then he was very much depressed. "See, the Muslim Jamindar has come. He has given 16 acres. I do require 16 acres. The gardening is to be done. So many other things are to be, occupational institutions are to be started. So I want 16 acres, but Raja Maharaj says that I should not take 16 acres. So he was very much grieved. So he went to sleep. In this dream, Swami Vivekananda appeared. He said, "I want all the 16 acres. Our work is going to expand, so you take all the 16 acres. Then he got up and then wrote a letter to headquarters. Last evening, Swami Vivekananda came in a vision and told he wants all the 16 acres. Then immediately headquarters told, all right, you take all the 16 acres. So he took all the 16 acres and started different institutions. He started teaching the children exercises, occupation, weaving, carpentry, agriculture, all these things he started teaching the poor people. And he was the first man who started the Swadeshi movement. We all think that Gandhiji started in 1921. It is 1897. Swami Akhandananji, he started wearing khadar. He started spinning and weaving on the local looms and wearing that khadar. One cloth around his waist and another one around his head like a turban. So he was the person who prepared or who wove khadar in 1897, some 24 years earlier than Gandhiji started the khadar movement. And he told all the young people who were telling Swadeshi, Swadeshi. What do you mean by Swadeshi? Simply shouting won't do. You must feed the poor people. You must clothe the poor people. You must educate the poor people. This is Swadeshi movement. If you do this, the country will awake and you will get freedom. And his slogan to everyone was, Swamiji has given you the call, arise, awake. So awake from the tamas. You are sleeping. Awake. See what is happening around you. How you can help the poor people. How you can free your country. How you yourself can be better than simply living like slaves. Awake from the tamas, awake from the tamas, he used to say. He worked all day and meditated all night. Slept once in 2 or 3 days and ate only rice and lemon. Lemon used to be grown in the garden. With lemon juice, he would eat rice. Days after days, weeks after weeks, and read books after books. Every type of books he used to read. So he was an ideal like Swamiji. Great Karma Yogi, great Jnana Yogi, and great scholarly person. So he would tell others, look, it is not the food that is important. It is your enthusiasm, it is the power, it is the desire to know, read books, meditate, work hard. This is how you can drive away the tamas. In 1934, Swami Shivananji was the president of our order. he passes away. Then the trustees elect Akhandananda as the president. So he became the president of our order in 1934. For 3 years he was the president. In 1936, centenary of Sri Ramakrishna came. Then people from headquarters went. He was staying in Sargachi. And so though he was the president, he was staying in Sargachi. Now and then he would come to Belur Mutt. So when 1936 centenary came, he had to give a message as the president of the order to the whole world organization. So they came for a message from him. Then he wanted to write a message about Sri Ramakrishna. When Sri Ramakrishna appeared before him and then said, "What are you writing? You are writing my centenary message. Do you think I am 100 years old? I am the Sanatana Brahma and I have no 100 years or 200 years. Why do you write this? Don't write." So he gave up. So next day all the people came and then said, "Sir, we want the message." No. So Sri Ramakrishna has told me, "Am I born on that day? So that you celebrate my centenary, you don't be in that. "Sir, somehow you must get a message. Otherwise, what will all our centers in the foreign they do? They all want to publish this. Somehow you must get this message." Again, Akhandananda prayed to Sri Ramakrishna. And suddenly in the early morning, Akhandananda got up and in a frenzy, he started writing something. Somebody is dictating and he is writing. So he wrote a big message in Bengali and gave it to those people when they came next day. And when Swami Madhavananji was the editor of the souvenir and all that, so when he read that message, one place he could not understand what it was. So he came to Akhandananda Swami and asked, "This particular place we do not understand what you have written." He said, "Do I understand? I also don't know. What was dictated, I have written, that's all. As much as you can, you understand. I also do not understand." That means Sri Ramakrishna himself has dictated that. So that is how he was always in touch with Sri Ramakrishna. So in 1936, Holy Mother's birthday came. That day from morning till evening, he was engaged in the celebration. He was feeding thousands and thousands of people. And in the evening again, the bhajan started. That bhajan, etc., ended by 9:30. Then he started singing in his own room, bringing so many devotees. Then he went to Holy Mother in the morning there. And he used to salute Holy Mother and Sri Ramakrishna by telling a shloka which nobody else would utter. Only he would utter the shloka. That was, "Kasturika Chandana Lepanaye Smashana Bhasmanga Vilepanaya Satkundalaye Cha Panikundalaya Namas Shivaye Cha Namas Shivaya." So he used to say, "Oh Mother, you are anointed with Kasturika Chandana and your husband Shiva is anointed with only Smashana Bhasma, the Bhasma from the cremation ground. And Satkundalayach, you are wearing the golden earrings and your husband is wearing serpent earrings. So these are Namah Shivayach Namah Shivaya. Oh Mother Shiva, oh Father Shiva, so my salutations to you." This is how he used to salute. On that day he saluted them and he did not take any food. He was so much full of joy. He would say, "I will take food afterwards. It became 10 p.m. in the night. Then also he did not take any food. Then somehow they forced him to take some food. Even then afterwards he started singing and went on singing up to 1:30 a.m. And at that time all other people got tired. He said, "All right, go and take rest. You see, I am 72 years old. How Sri Ramakrishna is playing with this body." He told all of them. They all went to rest. Then the same year, the next year, 1937, February, the birthday of Swami Vivekananda came. On that day also, from morning till evening, he was busy with puja, feeding the poor, and at 10 p.m., they brought the prasad. "Sir, you have not taken anything. Please take something." Then he said, "What will you give me? I was in meditation. I went to Swamiji's place. So I was with Swamiji in Swarga. He gave me so many good things to eat. Then afterwards she took a little prasadam and sent him away. I was with Swami Vivekananda all the while, he was telling. So there is another one incident with which we may close. So the famous leader, Golwalkar, he was his disciple. So Golwalkar was a student in Banaras Hindu University at that time, studying in MSc. So he would go on summers and then serve his guru. So one day he was serving and then he was kneeling before his guru and then praying to him, "Sir, you bless me, please bless me that I may have Brahma Jnana." Akhandananda Swami raised his hand over his head and then said, "Yes, you will have Brahma Jnana." That one of our Swamis was seeing it. So one of our Swamis also felt, "I must also ask for Brahma Jnana," as Golwalkar asked. So when Akhandananda Swami came out from his room, then this Swami was thinking in his mind, "I must also ask for Brahma Jnana," as Golwalkar asked. Then Akhandananda Swami, as he came in front of the Swami, he turned to the Swami and told him, "Yes, those that ask for something, they certainly will get it. But those that do not ask, they will get much more." Akhandananda Swami told him and walked away. This is a great message, that those that ask, they get, but those that do not ask, they get more. So God is pleased with those devotees who don't ask for anything. God gives out of his bounty. So last days, Swami Akhandananji, he used to bless everybody. "I bless everyone. Why should I be cheated? Those that have helped me, them also I will bless. Those that hindered me, them also I will bless. I will not be cheated anymore, because God dwells in everyone." And then he used to say, "I see everybody's inside as if somebody sees through a glass almira all the things inside." Then one great statement he makes, he tells all the people around him, he says, "You give me all your sins, I will take all your sins and take all my merits, all my punya, because I am not afraid of sins. I know I belong to Sri Ramakrishna, no sins can come to me. So I can take away all your burden and I can give you all the merits that I have. And this burden is not going to affect me. I know I belong to Sri Ramakrishna, I am completely fearless, no sin can do anything to me." It was one of the greatest statements that any Brahmajnani can do. The Brahmajnani is the only person whom neither sin can touch nor merit can touch. He is beyond the sin and merit. So that is how he can take the sins of all others and remain pure, even as like the fire. Fire destroys all the impurity. It remains pure. It doesn't get impure by itself. So then he used to say, "I am not going to die in Sargachi." He used to live in Sargachi. "I am not going to die at Sargachi. And I will be till the last day, but I will be at Sargachi. And then I will die at Belurmat. And sadhus of Belurmat will carry me." He used to tell this even before his passing away. When the last day came, that was on 6th June 1937, 6th February 1937, he went into coma, and then by coma they brought him by the train to Belurmat, and then they made him sleep by the side of Swami Vivekananda's room. On 7th February 1937, evening 3 p.m., he attained Mahasamadhi. All the three of his statements became true. Till the last day he was there, last day of his life, then he went into coma. Then the Swamis of the mission went there and they carried him. And he passed away in Belurmat on the 7th day. So he was an embodiment of what Swami Vivekananda called Shivajnane Jeevaseva, serving God in man. So he, all his life, he saw God only in every person. So he served every type of person. Wherever there is difficulty was there, Akhandananda used to be there. He was the person who first started the first relief work of the mission. And he exhibited in his life that one can be a great bhakta, one can be a great jnani, one can be a great karma yogi, and one can be a great yogi also. All these four he showed, an ideal follower of Swami Vivekananda. That is why Swami Vivekananda said, you see, a leader should not show any partiality. Otherwise, leader will destroy his whole following. But somehow or other, Gangadhar, I have what special love for you. So Swamiji had a special love for Gangadhar. So because of this all-round development, an ideal man, Swami Akhandananda ji, so such a great person's life, we could reminisce a few of the instances in his life, and it is our great good fortune that on this sacred day we could remember him. May we pray to Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swamiji and Swami Akhandananda, that they may bless us all, so that our worldly life as well as our spiritual life may be a great success. Niranjanam nityamanantarupam bhaktanukampadhrita vigraham vai ishavataram parameshamidyam tam Ramakrishnam shirasanamamah.